not feeling too adventurous tonight, so I'm starting off just having a regular beer. A beer that tastes like beer from Dewclaw Brewing in Baltimore, Maryland. Just a nice, boring, standard American craft lager. Nothing fancy. Yeah, just a regular old beer. So tonight, I don't have any finished project or anything super special to talk about. I've been busy with a bunch of different things and haven't really got one cohesive thing to show you tonight. I do have some movement forward on this thing, which is the controls for the DIY lame attempt at a skycam. I've got all of the winches upgraded to the latest version and mounted up and installed in their various places. This one was a bit difficult to get in, which I think I'd pointed out before, just because it is so far over from where I can stand. I did discover, though, that when I built this part of the railroad, I built it relatively strong, and I actually was able to kneel up on top of it, so I got that guy installed up there as far over as I could, I dared to get. Then number four in the corner over there had a similar issue. It's quite deep in the back there, so I had to sort of lean and try not to break anything. And just up in this corner, I had to get a bit creative with the mounting because the exit pipe for my sump pump is in the way, so I had to adapt a little bit to get the eye bolt that guides the line up close to the ceiling, kind of like the rest of them. Not that I'm expecting precise geometry, but might as well try. And to do that, you notice I had to get the winch at a bit of a wonky angle just so that everything lined up, but it seems to work reasonably well. And then at this part down here, I've still got the four push buttons programmed the same, but I added in this infrared receiver, which is the same one that comes in most of your standard Arduino starter kits. And I spent a bunch of time learning the codes off this remote control and hacking together some even more lame code to control it, absent the finesse code that my teenager promised me, but now he's back in university classes, so he doesn't have any time. So I don't know when that's going to happen, but this rough code moves everything, so that's something anyways. So power on the digital stuff, 5 volts, power on the 24 volts that powers the motors, and then these four buttons still do the same thing. But now, when I hit the remote control, I can make them all move together, or one at a time. So that makes them all move up. That makes them all move down. Then I can move each one individually in. So there's motor 1, 2, 3, 4. And 5 through 8 moves those four motors in the opposite direction, so winds the spools out. The only problem I'm having with this, well, among the problems, is it seems like the IR remote library takes an awful long time to do its thing, so it moves really slow. But I think, as you saw when I'm using the push buttons, it moves plenty fast enough. So I don't know, that's a software problem. The hardware, I've got to a relatively stable point now, I think, or at least a point that I can live with. So we'll just let that settle for a while until I've got some software figured out, or until my teenage coder has some software figured out. And he showed me a while ago, he does have the geometries figured out. It's just a matter of translating it to actually moving the stepper motors. So that's one of the things that I'm working on and keeping me busy. Another thing that's been keeping me busy is learning more about this thing and making some minor modifications to it. Since I mentioned that I got it, I've added these little lights to it here on these little stands, just prints from Thingiverse. And the lights themselves are just LED strips that are stuck onto these little printed bits. And for now, they're just being powered out of this little buck converter back here, which is coming off a wall wart. Is that buck or boost? That's a boost, actually, because the wall wart is 8 volts and the LED strips are 12. So, okay. And then, if you remember the little Raspberry Pi Zero W that I got in a mailbag a while ago, I think I showed you this case that I printed with, for it, with unfortunately broken hinge because it was a little ham-fisted taking it off the bed. Anyway, I've got Octopi loaded up on there. The Raspberry, Octopi, that's Octoprint, the Raspberry Pi version of Octoprint. And for right now, it's just connected with this USB on-the-go adapter and this cable because I don't have a USB hub. Actually, I don't have a functioning USB hub right now that has the right combination of connectors and stuff and adapters to get out of the USB micro and into another USB micro there and through the hub. So that means I can't connect a webcam yet. I've got a couple of them that I'm going to try. This is just an ancient cheap VGA one. And if that doesn't work, then I've got this Microsoft, whatever, LifeCam, I think it's called. I guess I should back up a little bit. So Octoprint, and the Octopi, the Pi version, allows you to remotely control the printer. This USB essentially acts like a serial cable to send commands. And then this connects to my local Wi-Fi, and I can connect to it from any of the computers in the house. So I don't have to run up and down the stairs with micro SD cards to send prints here and start prints. I can do it remotely. I'll show you that in a second. But the other thing that Octoprint can do is show you a webcam view of what's going on your printer. So you can watch it from upstairs or on your phone or whatever. Or if you poke a hole in your firewall, you can't actually watch it from anywhere on the planet, but I don't know that I'd want to trust my printer and my network to do that. So here's Octoprint. I am actually logged into that Raspberry Pi from my shop computer here. I just click the connect button. I am now connected, and the terminal view shows that I'm receiving stuff from the printer. Just status messages, basically. So I can upload my G-code file from my computer to the SD card that's currently sitting in the Ender 3. This takes a little while, depending on the size of the file. Okay, so now that that code is uploaded, I can just click on print, or I can preset the or start things heating. Okay, and that should start preheating the bed and the nozzle. But while that's happening, I can still send this print job to the printer. And one, you can see the temperatures are starting to come up here. There's the target flat lines for the bed and the nozzle. And the bed and the nozzle temperatures are starting to come up. So once those come up, it should start printing. And you can see on the printer that the temperatures are coming up too. It's targeting 60 on the bed, and it's at 52. It's targeting 200 on the nozzle, and it's at 197 right now. So it should start printing fairly shortly. And there it goes. And we'll check back in on that guy after a while and see how it's doing. See if it's actually printed. This is, you may have noticed, this is the third revision of this file that I've done. So we'll see how it's going after a while. So one thing anybody who's got a 3D printer will probably know is there's a fairly steep learning curve to actually creating your own parts and stuff. Here's a previous revision of that one that's currently on the bed printing. So this is, I'm hoping, going to be a little illuminated dog tag kind of thing. I'm planning on sticking some 5mm LEDs in there. These ones are the multicolor self-flashing ones, not the single color ones that Big Clive's playing with. It's these ones here. They should change through, it's going red, green, blue, and just cycling through the whole thing. Sorry about that PWM that you're seeing, but not much I can do about that. Anyway, my plan is to have three of those sticking out of this little print here with a 2032 battery in there. However, I made that a little bit tight. The battery itself fits in okay, but with the LEDs in there, they're sticking inside the case, so I didn't account for that. So that just barely fits. The other thing I didn't account for is the distance from the bottom of the case to there. So the battery is hung up on right on there, and there's nothing really to press this lead here against the bottom of the battery. So that's something that I'm hoping to deal with in... Actually, no, I didn't do anything about that part in this revision. I'm just doing the size right now. So we'll see what happens with that. And I'm no doubt going to have to make 3 or 4 more iterations of this. Part of the learning curve for this is just learning what the printer does and how it reacts to the code that you give it. And part of it is learning the CAD process itself, which until very recently I've never done CAD at all, or any kind of drafting really. So I have been experimenting and I've settled on a couple of different programs. I've settled on a couple of different open source programs specifically. This guy I made in OpenSCAD or OpenSCAD, which is mostly, it's sort of a code-based, you tell it, make a cylinder, make it this big around, make it this tall, make another cylinder, put it in the middle of it, a little bit smaller, and cut that, use that as a remove or a cut. Then make another cylinder, set it at 90 degrees to the first one, make it smaller, 5 millimeters in this case, or 5.1, and make that a cut, and rotate, make another one, and make another one. So you just define each piece separately and join them all together. The other program that I'm trying to figure out is FreeCAD. As I said, I'm trying very hard to stick to Linux compatible and open source. Not cloud-based, not subscription-based, none of that stuff. Just for reasons. So the other thing that I'm trying to design and is giving me trouble is kind of a slip cover that goes onto Christmas lights to make them more like a traditional Christmas light and less like an LED sticking in a tree. And I've iterated, as you can see, through a few different versions. This one is actually one that I downloaded from Thingiverse. It's not bad, but it's not the right size for a 5mm LED, and it's not the right size for... So these LEDs here, these WS2811s that I used for the Christmas lighting on the outside of the house, I'm trying to get them to look a little bit more like a traditional Christmas bulb. So I said that's one that I downloaded from Thingiverse. Obviously, it's too small. That one's almost the right size, but it was too weak. It was too thin up on the top. And that's part of the problem that I'm having, striking a balance between thin enough on the upper part that the LED can actually shine through, and both thick enough and the right diameter on the bottom here to actually slip over this thing. I'm not even sure if I'm just going to go down that far or if I'm going to go further down. But I've been trying both FreeCAD and OpenSCAD, and that's the OpenSCAD version. That one and this one, they're both the same thing. This one I just, in the slicer rather than printing it on top of the bed, I pushed it down halfway through the bed so it would print a cutaway version, just so I could see what was going on inside. As you can see, it gets quite a bit thicker in there, and that made a dark band which didn't shine through and make a pleasing light. Plus, as you can see on the outside, there's this ugly step. So that was, again, that was just an early experiment. It's, I don't know, some people might find CAD very intuitive. I don't. I'm working on it. I'm getting there. I'm finding actually for simple stuff like this, OpenSCAD is easier. I'll get there eventually. I shouldn't whine too much, but anyway, other things that I've been printing just for fun, some cable management clips, which came out pretty well. So I'll be using those in places like that up under the railroad where there's a bunch of wires coming in and out. Now, those nylon P clips that you see there work well, but they're not very good if you're adding and subtracting and changing wires a lot. So I figured those printed clips might work pretty well for that job. And another little handy print that I've done recently that work pretty well is that one, just to hold those guys. And again, that's just another random one off Thingiverse. There's about 50 different versions of them. This is just one that I happened to pick. And it seems to work pretty well for its job. Well, this thing looks like it's about halfway through and it hasn't turned into a bird's nest yet, so that's a good sign. The one thing I am discovering about 3D printing and about figuring it out is that you do tend to generate a fair bit of plastic scrap. I'm not quite sure what I'm going to do with that yet. Can't throw it away, of course. There's another failure in that little project. I was trying to print it a little bit thicker. And, yeah. So it looks from this that we're getting pretty close. That says layer 46, 47 down there. There are 51 layers. So, yeah, it's getting fairly close to the end. I think I'll just pause and come back when that's done. Okay, and there it is. Nothing left to do but to get it off the bed. It would have come off easier if I'd waited for the bed to cool down, but it's still 55 or so degrees Celsius, but that's not bad. Let's see if it fits. So it's a little bit bigger. Let's get that out of there. Yeah, there's kind of a shim that I stuck under there just to make that work. So that is bigger. I hope it's not too much bigger. The hole still fits the LED. That's good. That goes in there and there's still room to spare, huh? I'll grab a couple more LEDs. This might actually be a somewhat of a success. And I still have to iterate on this to get the get a lid onto it and stuff like that, but maybe, just maybe, this can actually work. And I need to put a little bit of a bend in that just so that it will make contact. This might be a problem. But they all fit in there. I'm going to have to do something to hold them in. There, that actually physically fits. It actually holds in there pretty solidly. And then that is just to put some fishing line or something through just to hang it off the dog's collar. And then when he's walking at night in the dark, because dark comes early these days, he will be easier to spot at night. Let me just futz around with those wires a little bit on the bottom. Obviously, I need to put something or modify this model to a version 4 just to put a little thicker pad in the middle there. Shouldn't be too hard to do, but the iteration continues. Yeah, I think on a dark winter's evening, that will make my buddy Lance the dog a lot easier to spot at night. I know this probably wasn't the video you came here looking for, but it wasn't really the video that I was planning on making either, but such is life. Sometimes the real world gets in the way and we don't have time to do exactly what I wanted. Anyway, thanks for watching, those of you who actually made it this far. Comments and questions down below as usual. I will get back to doing things and I will talk to you later.